has been passed in the outside edge half a dozen times out there. And that was a good one. One more run added to take the total at the end of the day up to 227.44. Michael Atherton, 113. Nick Knight, 57. That was a good opening stand of 148. Then John Crawley, 14. Graham Thorpe, 19. The West Indies fought back there. And Richard Illingworth, the night watchman, unbeaten on 8 at the end. And Graham Hick on 6. 10 extras, 227.44. And the West Indies, they stuck to it very well, I thought. Did a good job today. England could have got away and made something around about the 300 mark on that pitch and in these conditions. Walsh, none for 61. The wicket takers, Bishop, 1 for 41, and Benjamin, 2 for 36. Danrose, 77 from 24 overs, and Atherton, 8 from 4 overs. So both sides would be reasonably pleased. Michael Atherton should be pleased that England have done as well as they have.
To be.
Michael Atherton's century put England in the driving seat yesterday. It was a fine innings and certainly a very timely one. The problem for England late in the day, however, with John Crawley, Atherton and Graham Thorpe all dismissed, and it was the West Indies new boys who did the job. Stuart Williams took a brilliant slip catch. Raji Danrash fought quickly to run out Atherton, and then Courtney Brown took the catch to dismiss Thorpe. Welcome to highlights of the second day of this fifth Cornhill Test match at Trent Bridge. 6.25 hours of very good and tough and competitive cricket yesterday, and more to come today. This is the way it all started out for England. 227 for 4. Knight made 57, Atherton 113, Crawley 14 and Thorpe 19. And Illingworth is listed there as not out 8, with Hick not out 6, 10 extras, 227 for 4. But unfortunately, England effectively are 227 for 5 because Illingworth broke his finger in defending against this ball from Courtney Walsh yesterday after he'd been sent in as night watchman. Now the man who did the damage there for Richard Illingworth, Courtney Walsh, didn't take a wicket but bowled 26 overs and 4 maidens for his 61 runs. The wicket takers were Ian Bishop, 1 for 41, and Kenny Benjamin, 18 overs, 7 maidens and 2 for 36. Dan Rash didn't get anywhere with the field placings he had set for him. 24 overs, 2 maidens, none for 77, but I promise you he spun the ball very, very sharply, which might be an indication for the England spinners later in the game. And Keith Atherton, 4 overs, no maiden, and no wicket for 8. So yesterday, some turn there, not much pace for the quick bowlers, and here's today's pitch report from Geoffrey Boycott.
Well, I've got with me Ron Alsop, the Notts groundsman. How long have you been groundsman here, Ron?
Well, for 40-odd years, Geoffrey.
40-odd years, and you've still not learnt how to make a good test speech.
well, we'll judge this later, shall we?
Is this one of the best you've actually made?
No, it isn't, Geoffrey, no. It's a superb batting wicket, isn't it? But it's not one of the best I've made. One of the best I've made would be I'd want bounce and a bit more pace.
So this pitch here, it's really not going to change much throughout the game. It's just got a nice cover in, it's no pace and bounce, and you'd say this will stay the same all through the match.
I would probably think that it would even get slower.
Would you?
I would think it would even get slower with this hot sunshine.
Ball a bit lower as well?
Ball is a bit lower. I would hope at some stage that it would turn.
If they can spin it?
If they can turn the ball these days.
Thanks, Ron. Have a good retirement.
Okay, thanks very much, Geoffrey.
Bit of arthritis in Ron's left shoulder there, but he'll be all right in retirement. It was Craig White who came out with Graham Hick, with Richard Illingworth still in the pavilion with that finger injury. And it's Hick who takes strike now. It's the last ball of the second over of the day. One run has been added to the overnight score, and the bowler is Courtney Walsh. Yep. Now, Chief Dan Rose, just the man down at deep third man. He's got quite a good throwing arm over long distance as well as short. We saw the short distance yesterday when he ran out Michael Atherton with a very smart piece of work.
I think Ian Bishop starting well this morning, just making sure that the batsman plays with everything that he bowls. Bowling wide and short on this pitch will not help. It's necessary to bowl wicket to wicket, make sure that the batsmen play at all times.
Oh, well stopped. Been one or two revelations in this West Indian side in recent times. Stuart Williams, who's come into the side, is a very, very good slip fielder, and Sherwin Campbell, who saved that boundary, has distinguished himself on a number of occasions. Called, and once again very, very well saved by Sherwin Campbell. And he's gone, caught behind and very well bowled by Ian Bishop. That is the crucial wicket for the West Indies. They've got through this pair, Hick and White. White having to come out in place of Richard Illingworth, who's injured, and now it's 239 for five, but really it's 239 for six.
Well, Ian Bishop has been threatening to do this. He's been bowling very straight this morning, just wide of the off stump, and bringing Craig White onto the front foot, pulling him wider than he probably wanted to play, and straight into Courtney Brown's glove. Excellent bowling, I think, by Ian Bishop this morning.
.239 for five. Illingworth injured, and that first replay we showed you, we'll look at it again. Just watch the swing. It's late swing there, and just keeps going. It's beautifully bowled.
That's nicely timed by Jack Russell. Pretty handy way to get off the mark. Perfect delivery, nearly perfect, we say. Had it been perfect, he might have taken the wicket. Ian Bishop has got himself into good form this morning. He's just getting this ball to move away from the right-handers. We'll watch it. Well, there are all sorts of ways of getting out in cricket. All you need to make sure is you don't get out to the silly ones. Courtney Walsh did well to get this high and just that little bit quicker too. The one thing that Graeme Hick was in danger of doing there, having firstly been beaten for pace and bounce. The main danger after that, he's felt the blow and doesn't know where the ball's gone, but he then tries to brush it away with his hand, which of course would have counted as handled the ball. Remember Graeme Gooch at Old Trafford a couple of seasons ago against Australia was given out in exactly the same fashion. Applause for the 250. England now 251 for five. That's becoming a habitual sight for Richard Illingworth. Padding around broken digits. His hands have taken a bit of a pummeling this year.
Sounded good. And was good.
Yes, it's very noticeable when Graeme Hick is batting that the West Indies quick bowlers want to test him out with a short ball, get a bouncer in there. They feel he's pretty vulnerable. But on this particular pitch, with no great pace and bounce, I think it's more in favour of the batsman, and it's playing into Graeme Hick's hands.
an appeal there. But it looked as if Graeme Hick missed what was a full toss. Jeffrey.
Well, I was just waiting to see if he got a little inside edge, but no, the umpire signaled leg by. This is a full toss. Well, it just might have been leg side of leg stump. A very close decision. If that hits him in line, full toss, then it should be out, but it's very close.
Fine shot. It almost got faster and faster. I think Ian Bishop set off in hope, but suddenly struck a moment of complete disillusionment as the ball raced away through extra cover.
Well, there's a good shot. Lovely attacking gesture from the England wicketkeeper and all-rounder. I think it was all that short.
I think Jack Russell actually made a step forward here and then went back and dismissed it. That's the only way you describe that, dismissive.
A nice shot. So there's two balls in this over, a bit too short. But Zane Raj needs to keep the ball up to the bat, so too does Benjamin. But not a full toss. A very, very useful partnership between Graeme Hick, who's 39, and Jack Russell, who's 23. Pressure on the fielder. And Russell got back to two. That's excellent running. That's two in as many overs. Dan Raj's bowled as full tosses to Graeme Hick, and Hick has dealt very, very severely with them. 300 up for England now. Be satisfactory from their point of view to get over the 300. Another full toss. He's fetching them from outside off stump, but a full toss can never be disguised as anything but a full toss. 51 for Graeme Hick now.
Nicely improvised by Graeme Hick. A lot of the gaps in the outfield have been plugged by fielders in the deep. Graeme Hick just found one that hasn't been. No ball and four runs too. Perfectly struck. We've seen many a hat perched on top of spectators' heads, and very sensibly too. Just in case anyone's forgotten to bring one, there's either Jeffrey Boycott collection or the end of season sale there in the caravan. Well, well bowled.
Yes, I was just thinking that the game's drifting along since quite a way before lunch. And I think that the West Indies have got to try something, some sort of variation. The game's just drifting along. They don't look as if they're going to get a wicket now.
Oh, beautifully bowled and nicely taken. Jack Russell is gone. The same sort of delivery that he nibbled at in the previous over from Ian Bishop. This time he's got the edge, and Courtney Brown had to move low and quick to his left, but completed the catch. And so this partnership between Graeme Hick and Jack Russell now over, with Jack Russell out, Court Brown, bowled Bishop for 35.
Well, he's been trying to run the ball across Jack Russell. Jack Russell made one lovely forcing back foot shot, left one or two, occasionally played and missed, and eventually he's nicked one.
And so England 323 now for six. And Mike Watkinson will be the new batsman. Courtney Walsh back on the field. Richard Richardson's gone off the field. So Otis Gibson is still there, and Courtney Walsh will be the man holding the reins for the moment.
Well, that's a full toss. That was easy. Just made a little stride down the pitch. That's not the sort of delivery you want. When you're trying to put the new batsman under pressure, up it went, too far. Nice little feet movement, little chasse, and that's too easy to hit.
That's a good shot. Almost as though he was waiting for it. A square cut. It's been very severe on anything short outside the off stump.
Short and wide in the second afternoon of a test match on this pitch is not where you should be bowling.
At five full tosses, Dan Raj has bowled today. He's bowled them all to Graeme Hick, and Hick has collected 20 runs from them. That'll take some catching on this fast outfield. That's a good shot. Very fine sweep. Didn't attempt to hit the ball hard, quite deliberately just kept it low key, but played down on it, rolled his wrists. Very nice.
Something of that ambitious drive there by Watkinson, just outside off stump, perhaps trying to emulate Graeme Hick.
Now then, those three chaps who are sitting there, we're talking about the one in the middle in the black and white striped cap is Blue Food, who plays the conch shell. Maybe a lot of people who play the conch shell in the world, but none play it any better than Blue Food. He's from Trinidad, and he's at all the big cricket matches there, and they haven't had much to celebrate so far. There have been one or two conch shell blowings, but they really get stuck in when the wickets start to fall, and there's been very little of that so far. But he is quite a character. Good shot again. Graeme Hick has played some excellent strokes in recent overs, starting with that pull shot he played off Ian Bishop. A
And then again, he's working across the line, and that was dangerous.
Well, might just have missed, I think. But what a shout, certainly. Pitch just outside off stump, perhaps.
Well, that's better. Beautiful shot. Four runs all the way, and it's just the right moment to go down and have a chat and say, come on, keep playing straight and just play the shots you always play, including that one. Well, he was lucky that time. Looking to play an attacking stroke on the offside. Gets an inside edge down to fine leg, and four runs.
A little bit of luck here for Watkinson. Bat well away from the body.
Thick edge down to third man. One more to Watkinson. Brings up the 50 partnership between Watkinson and Hick.
And Courtney Walsh has decided that, well, it's very difficult to get anybody out in this type of pitch, and he's decided that he's not going to allow too many runs, too many boundaries.
A lovely stroke. And it's gone all the way. And the difference there for Mike Watkinson was that he aimed the ball much, much straighter, just wide of mid-on, so much better than trying to turn everything to square leg. That's out, and Mike Watkinson pays the penalty for playing across the line, not for the first time. Right from the start, he seemed so keen to work the ball on the onside. And I just thought he'd straighten it out with that on drive in the last over. But out he goes, LBW bowled Benjamin for 24, and the seventh wicket is down for 380.
Yes, you're right, Tony. He does like to work the ball, but he never gets a big stride forward. That's the problem. And that's what the umpire will take into consideration, that he's working across it. Nice little innings he played, but if you watch the front foot here, I mentioned about an hour ago, he plays with a very left foot, stiff leg. See how stiff that left leg is? It's never got beyond the batting crease even.
Incoming batsman, Dominic Cork.
Beautifully hit. The field is in for Dominic Cork. No one was ever going to catch that one.
Like young Darren Goff, he doesn't poke around for too long when he's at the crease. Don't hang around too long, get the scoreboard ticking over. Especially if the batsmen have done their job and got the bowlers a bit tired, like has happened here. We're now into the fifth session. Those West Indies, oh dear, that's a bit silly. I was going to say, those West Indies fielders are a bit tired. And that was just about summed it up there. Just getting a bit down, flat, concentration's going a little bit.
Could be a close relative of mine, that. Definitely the way to travel. Last time I saw one of those, it was 150 feet above the football ground at Carrara, just off the Gold Coast in Australia. 4 1/4 hours he's been batting now. That's a great shot. That's going to race to the boundary for Graeme Hick's first 100 against the West Indies. Much deserved applause from his captain, his teammates, And the packed house here at Trent Bridge. 100 not out exactly, 15 fours, and coming off 183 balls. It's his third Test match 100. The other two against India and South Africa. And he'll add two more to it now. And Graeme Hick in his 36th Test match. For him, that's a poor ratio. He's the man that's made many, many hundreds in first-class cricket.
Problems there. Looked as though it might have been an ankle. Just the turn and twist in the bowler's footmarks. Didn't like the look of that too much. Ian Bishop is the bowler.
Oh yes, you could see that immediately there, that Ian Bishop had problems as he put the foot down. He turned and was, I think, just good enough to deliver this, but surely his foot was twisted there. He had some problems yesterday with boots. He's changed them a couple of times. Nasty.
Well, at last he's decided that the common sense thing to do is to go from the field. Not too sure he even gave Courtney Walsh a wave, but he might do now. In the air, but it's safe. Shot. Court goes to 30.
Caught him, beautifully caught. Super catch. And another great reward for Kenny Benjamin. Dominic Cork goes to 31, a most useful 31. Real thorn in the flesh of the West Indians. But Courtney Brown has really impressed himself upon this match. 440 now for 8.
Well, Kenny Benjamin getting good reward here, just spearing the ball into the right-hander, not really moving it away as he normally does. Courtney Brown taking a really nice catch, moving swiftly to where a first slip would have been.
Orthodox outside edge, but very well taken by Courtney Brown. And a fourth wicket for Kenny Benjamin. So England down to the last batsman now, Gus Fraser. Over it goes. Well, that's terrific bowling by Kenny Benjamin. That little bit quicker, a bit of zip there. Gus Fraser goes first ball. .440 for 9, and the West Indies are looking now to see if Richard Illingworth will come out to bat, the man who retired hurt. The sign which comes says no, and so that completes the England innings. With Graeme Hick not out. A big great applause for Graeme Hick, 118 not out. Ray Illingworth says produce it, and produce it he did.
Yes, that was a very good performance from Graeme Hick, 118 not out. He was severe on all the bowlers, played one or two magnificent pull and hook shots off the quicker bowlers. And he gave Rajiv Dhanraj a little bit of stick at different times. Good effort from the bottom of the order there. It's very important for England to have bowlers who can bat down the bottom there, and also Jack Russell, who made 35. Watkinson got 24 and Cork 31. It's a bit of a replay of Old Trafford. 20 extras, 440 all out there. And the bowling figures for West Indies: Walsh none for 93, Bishop 3 for 62, Benjamin 5 for 105. A good wholehearted effort
Thought he bowled very intelligently, Kenny Benjamin. Dan Raj none for 137 from 40. And the left-hand spinner, Arthurton, 9 overs, no maiden, no wicket for 31. Well, we join play now with the West Indies batting, England having made their 440. It's the second ball of the third over. Angus Fraser is the bowler, Stuart Williams taking strike, and there are 2 runs on the board.
Well, it was a long half volley. Big gap at mid-off. And simply put, back to ball.
Very good, thoughtful positioning by Angus Fraser, it was, who called out to Mike Latherton. Mike Latherton fully understood what the bowler was thinking. And captain and bowler on the same wavelength. And I think that's right to Stuart Williams. I said all along, he has a short stride. He doesn't get forward far enough. And he does play the ball in the air.
And along the ground. Terrific shot. But again, what appears to be a half volley, in fact, is played on the up. And this is the point Angus Fraser was making. Both shots played on the up. And the man in there on the catch, 15 yards or so away, is really in business. But not this time.
That's a good firm shot. Stuart Williams, the batsman. And he's been very happy. Anything today that's been pitched up, he's really launched into. Nothing extravagant, just a good follow through. Good firm hit. Gets himself into a nice position.
He'd get that if the ball turned.
But what a shout, since he's pushing out just perhaps in front of off stump, but pitch outside off stump, and he did play a shot.
Now there's something that'll bring a bit of a smile to the face of Atherton and Watkinson and Illingworth. There's a bit of a problem there with Stuart Williams. Didn't seem to me that there's anything happened to Williams with this last ball. It jumped at him, hit him, but hit him on the waistband. A lovely question on question of sport, I suppose. And what happened next? Short of the man at Silly Point. Certainly two noises there.
Given a little bit more air here by Watkinson, and definitely hitting the inside edge. Just dropping in front of the man there at the point.
Desperate shouts. There's some spin. That's the one we were talking about when he gets that slight round arm delivery. Be a little disquieting for the dressing room.
A lot of turn and bunks there. I'm sure when Campbell must have been a little bit surprised.
No more runs added. Stuart Williams remained 16 not out, even though he looked as though he was ill out on the field there. And Sherwin Campbell, 8, 1 extra, no wicket for 25. So a good start for the West Indies. They got through without losing wicket. And the bowlers used for England, just 3 of them. Fraser, 6 overs, 4 maidens, no wicket for 9. Cork, 8 overs for 16. And Watkinson, 5 overs, 5 maidens, naught for naught, And I can tell you that ball is turning out there. It will be of great interest to Michael Atherton, and it'll have caught the eyes of the West Indian batsman as well. So at the close of play on the second day of this Cornhill Test, the West Indies 415 runs behind. And after play ended for the second day, David Gower talked with the man who made the century of this match, Graeme Hick.
Graeme, well played. Are you getting sick at having to make all these comebacks?
Well, I suppose it's my own sort of bad, I suppose, undoing that I'm sort of keep coming back. So if I got these runs all, you know, earlier on, then I suppose I wouldn't have to keep coming back. But I'm quite happy now. Yeah.
But how much do you feel the pressure then? Because the last two or three years, you've actually played some very good Test cricket. And yet two or three times it's come to the crunch and the selectors have said, OK, take a break and see what you can do later.
A little bit. As I say, I think, you know, if I'd got the runs, then I wouldn't put myself in that position. But, you know, once or twice I feel I was half expecting it, and another couple of times maybe I felt I was a little bit harsh, but it's the way it goes. So you can't do much about it apart from just keep trying to come back.
Now, how would you assess this Trent Bridge pitch? We've actually quite enjoyed watching you bat on it. It's not the worst pitch to bat on, is it?
No, it's obviously one you wouldn't mind carrying around, but I think it looks like it's going to maybe turn a bit more. A few turned quite nicely this evening, so obviously we'll hope for a bit more of that over the next few days.
And how satisfying was the innings for you? You've still got to get the runs, haven't you? However good the pitch is.
Yeah, true. I mean, this morning I went out and I just said I wanted to bat, you know, so I set up myself to try and bat 4 hours. I felt if I batted 4 hours at the crease, you know, then I'd be getting near to what I wanted. And as it turned out, it was about right. So, yeah, I was quite pleased with the way I'd played. I felt I hadn't done sort of too much wrong through the innings, so I'm quite happy.
Just tell us one more thing. This little chat you're reputed to have had with Ray Illingworth a couple of days before the game, was there much said in that?
No, it obviously was just after the situation at Old Trafford when, unfortunately, because I packed my bags and left early in the morning to go and play at Worcester, we hadn't had much time for a chat, so that's all it was. It was not a great deal, but I just felt that, you know, just wanted to have a chat with him, and I think he did with me as well, so it wasn't anything sort of over the top. We just had a quiet word.
But you feel as though you've cleared the air and you're now set for a long stay back in the side again?
Well, I hope so. I've got to keep getting some runs, so, but yeah, it'd be nice to have a long run. Yeah.
Well played. It was wonderful to watch.
Thank you.
A very happy man there, Graeme Hick, who joined Michael Atherton as one of the two century makers in this England side here in this most important game. Geoffrey Boycott now, and he has his ideas on everything that happened today and on what might happen tomorrow.
A very good day for England. They don't often make 400 runs plus, but an even better day for Graeme Hick. Before the start of this Test match, he wanted a few words with Raymond Dealingworth. Fine, he was disappointed, upset, probably a little angry at getting left out of the Old Trafford Test. Having got that off his chest, he did the next best thing possible. He made a century and made it well. I can only remember a couple of false shots. The rest of the time, he was in complete control, admittedly on a very good batting strip, but you can never do better than make the runs. Put the runs in the bank and let that do your talking. Having said that, I thought it was difficult for the West Indies on this pitch. Kenny Benjamin fully deserved his 5 wickets, pitching the ball up and moving it a little bit off the seam. The leg spinner Dan Raj got his opportunity to bowl, and I was very disappointed. He bowled it too slowly on this very slow surface. Tomorrow, well, England's spinners will have to do the trick for them. The finger spinners, I think, will have to bowl the ball a little bit quicker than Dan Raj. I think they should. Mike Watkinson and Richard Illingworth, a lot of overs, a few tricks up their sleeve, and put a little bit of pressure on the West Indies. That's the only real hope that England have got.
Here's plenty of good, hard, competitive cricket played so far in the 2 days of this Test match. And tomorrow we'll be with you at 10:45 a.m, the third day of the fifth Cornhill Insurance Test match. Coverage will be in grandstand. For the moment, from Trent Bridge, it's goodbye.
night. This is my house. And if you feel like clapping your hands, you can do that.